This video is made possible by the free-to-play action game Crossout. Check out the game through the link in the description below, and you can start with 3 extra weapons or a vehicle cabin just for registering. In the 1950s, US forces were stretched dangerously thin. US President Dwight D. Eisenhower stated of this, "My feeling remains that it would be impossible for the United States to maintain the military commitments which it now sustains around the world without turning into a garrison state did we not possess atomic weapons and the will to use them when necessary." No surprise from that. Unsatisfied with the portability of their shiny new M65 nuclear cannons, which required a couple of very large trucks to transport, and further unsatisfied that firing it off in many tactical situations would be a bit like killing a mosquito with a hand grenade, in the late 1950s, the US military brass for once were thinking a bit smaller. What they really wanted was a simple weapon that could launch a miniature nuclear warhead, could be carted around by a few soldiers, and could be fired relatively quickly and reliably. This would allow a handful of soldiers to successfully combat far superior forces on the other side, even at relatively close range, which none of the other nuclear weapons of the age could safely do. And this is where the Davy Crockett enters the picture. Rumor has it that the name was chosen in homage to the famed American politician, owing to the legend that he once grinned a bear to death, with the idea referencing the association between Russia and the Soviet Union in general with bears. Whether that's actually the reasoning behind the name or not, the first prototype of the Davy Crockett was completed in November of 1958 and ultimately deployed about 2.5 years later in May of 1961. Featuring a variant of the W-54 warhead contained in an M388 round, the projectile was fired from an M28 or M29 smoothbore recoilless gun. This was capable of launching the 10 or 20-ton yield nuke as far as about 1.25 miles for the M28 or 2.5 miles for the M29. As for portability, the Davy Crockett could either be deployed and fired from the back of a Jeep for maximum mobility, or even broken down into its components, with the pieces of the weapon being carried by 5 soldiers on foot. The general procedure for firing the 76-pound nuclear rounds was quite simple. First, a spotting round would be shot from an attached gun to ensure the weapon was aimed reasonably well. After this, in order to get the nuke to end up more or less where the spotting round did, the angle of the gun would have to be adjusted. To do this, a small book with pre-calculated tables was carried, giving adjustment figures for said angle. However, it turns out test firings with non-live nukes showed again and again that the Davy Crockett was an obscenely inaccurate weapon, possibly both because of the angle adjustments and that the weapon itself was smooth bore. Of course, the fact that the Davy Crockett was shooting a nuclear warhead helped make this inaccuracy issue not as much of a problem as would be the case with other similar weapons. Once the target was mildly locked on, the propellant charge would be inserted into the muzzle with a metal piston placed in after as a sort of cap. This was followed by the M388 round itself, containing the M54 warhead. As the M388 was far too big to fit inside of the bore, instead a rod would be attached to the back with the nuke sitting at the front. As for how the warhead would know when to detonate, there was a timer dial that would be set based on estimated distance to the target. This was calculated using figures given in the aforementioned book containing a spreadsheet of tables. However, contrary to what is often stated, the timer was not actually the thing that triggered the detonation. Rather, it simply armed the bomb once the time ran out. The actual trigger for detonation was a simple radar device in the back of the M388 that would detect how far above ground the nuke was. There was also a high and low switch that could slightly adjust height of detonation based on the radar reading. As you might have gleaned from all of this, and also contrary to what is often stated, the switch did not control the yield of the bomb, just at what height it would detonate above the ground, which was roughly 20 to 50 feet AGL, depending on the setting. It should be noted that unlike many other nuclear weapons, this was an otherwise dumb nuke. Once the timer was set and it was fired, it would either go off or would prove itself to be a dud. There was no aborting a detonation after launch. If all that is involved in firing the Davy Crockett sounds like it might take a long time, it turns out that's not at all the case given the destructive power of the weapon. One former Davy Crockett section soldier, Thomas Herman, notes that they were actually trained and very capable of firing a nuke every 2.5 minutes. All right, so now let's answer the question that's probably in your minds, and that's, well, just how deadly could this weapon be? While extremely low-powered as nukes go, the weapon nonetheless produced a blast in the ballpark of as large as the highest-yield non-nuclear explosive devices of the era. But unlike many of these, it was relatively small and portable. More important than this was its potential for extended damage long after the initial blast. This was particularly useful when fired around critical routes that enemy soldiers would have to traverse. Not only would the initial blast do significant damage to any soldiers and enemy vehicles around at the time, but the radioactive fallout, which would almost certainly be fatal to anyone within about a quarter of a mile of the initial blast when it went off, would remain for long after, making a given route, such as a mountain pass, impassable for several days after a detonation. Naturally, the Soviets could defend against this simply by equipping each of their soldiers with lead-lined refrigerators, but for whatever reason, they never seemed to have chosen to go for this route. On the other end of things, neither did the Americans. This was despite the fact that the Davy Crockett was also not terribly safe for those who were firing it. While 1.25 to 2.5 miles away is plenty of range to keep the soldiers who pulled the trigger safe from being harmed by the blast itself, in real-world scenarios, the enemy being fired upon could be closer, and some of your own troops, they might be closer still. Critical to all of this was also wind direction. With no winds, the radiation kill zone in the immediate aftermath of the blast was approximately 1,500 feet, but winds could easily blow dangerous radioactive particles towards one's own troops. As such, crew were instructed to, if possible, only fire the gun when suitable cover behind a hill or the like was available in order to help reduce radiation exposure. That said, presumably to try and get the soldiers operating the weapon to be slightly less hesitant about firing it, the instruction manual notes that the leader of the troop should instill a great sense of urgency in the soldiers operating the Davy Crockett, and to remember that, to quote, "the search for nuclear targets is constant and vigorous." The manual further states that if the nuke doesn't go off, the soldier should wait half an hour and then go and recover the supposedly armed nuclear bomb. Needless to say, while the Davy Crockett was deployed everywhere from West Germany to South Korea, with well over 2,000 of the M388 rounds made and 100 of the guns deployed, it was never actually used in battle. That said, the Army did do one test fire of the Davy Crockett with a live M388 round. This occurred during Operation Sunbeam in a test code named Little Fella 1, which took place on July 17, 1962. The nuke flew approximately 1.7 miles and detonated successfully about 130 feet above the ground, with an estimated yield of 18 tons from the blast. Interestingly enough, this was the last time the United States would detonate a nuke in the air close to the ground, thanks to the 1963 treaty banning nuclear weapon tests in the atmosphere, in outer space, and underwater. In the end, as cool as having a portable nuclear gun is and all, within only a few years the weapon would become antiquated, and by 1967 the Army was already beginning to phase it out, with it going the way of the dodo completely by 1971. This was no doubt to the eternal relief of the soldiers tasked with firing the thing should the need arise. So maybe you've been watching this video and thinking, wouldn't designing weapons be amazing? Well, if that's the case, number one, you might be a James Bond villain, and two, you should definitely download Crossout. Crossout is an online vehicle action game where all of the vehicles are made by the players. Basically, what you do is construct your own crazy vehicle from the ground up with all sorts of different parts. You can add weapons, support systems, the main structure, and, you know, a whole lot else to your vehicle. There's all sorts of things from rail guns to rocket boosters. Basically, you create your own amazing weapon and then you go and use it to destroy other people's. It's a super fast-paced game with lots of different game modes, and you've got pretty much limitless freedom to create, and what you do to your vehicle is entirely up to you. And it's not as complicated as you might think right at the start. In fact, the learning curve is very easy, and that allows you to make your own vehicle and just get into the game super quickly. There's loads of different game modes as well, so you're sure to find one you love. So you can join us on the battlefield for free, by the way, using the link in the description below, and it works on PC, Xbox One, PS4, so if you've got any of those, you're going to be fine. And going through that link below also helps support this show, which is cool, and you'll also get a free starter set with 3 extra weapons or a vehicle cabin, and that's all just for registering. So thanks to Crossout for the sponsorship, and thank you for watching.